So we're going to begin this morning with our worship with Bob Barner. And after Bob finishes, I'll come up and introduce the program speaker today, or some program speakers, I think, on the Blank Health Collaborative. But our devotional speaker this morning wants to be introduced very simply, so I'm glad to do that. It makes it easy. Bob Barner.
Good morning, Atlanta.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Today we're going to talk about Nehemiah. Nehemiah is a very interesting fellow. He's an Old Testament prophet, loved God, worked for a Persian king, lived in the palace, was on the king's court, and his job was that of a cupbearer. He tasted the king's wine before he drank it. And wouldn't that be a job like each and every one of them would like to have? All over the country would send him wine. He was a man that had a drink. He was a very trusted servant. The many topics in this book are nuggets that we're going to pursue when I have chosen one that really stands out. That one has a life-changing concept. I recommend everybody to read the book of Nehemiah. Just pay attention to his character and the position of Nehemiah. He was a trusted servant, a politician, a governor who never took advantage of his people. He was able to bridge the gap between the rich and the poor. He was a negotiator, a patient man, a wise man, a man of prayer. He was a leader, a coach, he was a motivational speaker. He never gave up and was tenacious of reaching his goal of rebuilding Jerusalem. This was taking place around 432 BC. To set the stage, Nehemiah is in the palace. He gets a distress message that the city of his people have been destroyed. The people have fallen away from God. They have fallen to worshiping idols, married pagan women, and the nation have been scattered. When he gets this message, the first thing he does is fast and pray. He knew he needed divine inspiration to help his people rebuild the city because there was a law, a proclamation by the king that stated no rebuilding and no construction in the city of Jerusalem. Nehemiah waits 4 months after getting the message to approach the king. It's at this time the Persians were celebrating and having a big extravaganza, celebrating a festival honoring their ancestors in the tombs. Nehemiah was with the king at this time, and Nehemiah was one of his favorites. The king noticed that he was sad. He approached Nehemiah and said, "Why are you so sad?" And Nehemiah told him. He says, "It gave me about the city being destroyed." But this time, the king gave Nehemiah special permission and proclamation to rebuild the city. He even gave him soldiers to help protect him. And two written documents. One, to let the governors in the area know that he had permission to rebuild the city. And the second one was the ability to go in the king's forest and cut timber. And at that time, nobody got the king's temper. It was a death sentence. Over a period of time, Nehemiah inspired the people to rebuild the city and come back to God. He brought in priests to remind the people who they were, to drop the pagan ways and have them sign documents that they would follow their laws. There were two governors in the surrounding areas that did everything they could to stop rebuilding of the city, even though Nehemiah had the documents. They attacked the city in and from the outside. It got so bad that the workers had to stand guard, half the workers had to stand guard for protection while the other half did the rebuilding. Several times, these governors asked Nehemiah to meet for a meeting, but he declined because they knew if they got together with them, they'd kill him. To keep working, many of the workers had to sell their property, even their children, to survive. The rich people at the time were called nobles, were charging between 40 and 50% interest when dealing with these people. Nehemiah found out about it, he stopped it, and help the people who lost their children and their property get it back. Through much adversity, the city gets rebuilt. And the last effort by these governors to cripple the city is they bring in the baddest, wickedest man they can find by the name of Balaam. He was a prophet. And Balaam cursed the area, he cursed the city. In the next sentence, it says, "But God turned the curse into a blessing." That's Nehemiah 13:2. They bring in the baddest man in the area to curse the city, and God turned the curse into a blessing. The nugget today we're going to talk about is building with a blessing. And if you really lean into this, it's going to change your life, your neighborhood, and your family. I come across this several years ago. I had a patient come in, very successful contract. I asked him, how did you become so successful? And he looked at me and smiled. He says, I got to tell you my story. He says, I'm an electrician. He says, several years ago, I decided to go on my own business. Because every time I went by these companies that were building and expanding, he says, I'd go by and say, I bless this building, I bless the company, and let the blessings come back on me. He'd have his kids in the back seat. The kids would laugh at him. He says, I kept that. He said, I bless them. Every time you go by, bless. So shortly after that, one of these companies called him up and he wanted to do a display. He went in and did the display. He did a good job, was on time. They started giving him a little more work. He hired a few more people. The next thing you know, they allowed him to build the construction of the entire building. New buildings. And that was all he wrote. He started building throughout the United States. The second kind of situation that I come across was in a neighborhood that was a bad neighborhood, normal neighborhood, but they have a strip mall. Quite a few buildings were vacant, suites were vacant. And the owner of the building put a strip club in there. And one of the neighbors in the neighborhood was going by and he noticed it. He said, I gotta do something about this. He didn't know what to do. So he started driving by, and every time he drove by, I cursed the bartender, I cursed the owner, I cursed the building. He would go back and forth. He said, over a year, every time I went by, back and forth, I cursed. He woke up one morning and says, this isn't working. I gotta change my tactics. So he started going by and said, bless me. I bless the owner, I bless the building, I bless the bartender. He said, he went by about 4 months later and noticed the business was closed down. A couple months later, the owner had refurbished the building. And he noticed all the vacancies were filled. I really had to get into the blessing and cursing business, and I found out the term blessing is used 496 times in the Bible. The curse, only 185 times. The first mention of the blessing is in Genesis 1:28, and we probably all know the story where God blesses Adam and Eve. And God said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule the fish of the sea, birds of the sky, and every creature that crawls out of the earth. This expresses the blessing on the use of the planet's renewable and non-renewable natural resources. I'm going to give you a clip. I'm not going to go from 496. I'm going to give you a clip edition. Next time we hear about it, God blesses Abraham. Then it comes down after Abraham's death. God blesses his son Isaac. And most of us know about the story about the stone of blessing. Jacob and Esau, where the mother deceived the father, and the youngest son, Jacob, got the blessing. Jacob also got blessed by God. And we go down to Genesis 48:8. This is important for everybody here. Where Jacob, the first thing he did when he saw his two grandsons was bless them. So now, not only do we have God blessing people, we have the grandfather blessing people. What changed in the book, in the word, was in number 6, 22 through 27. It's called the priestly blessing. The Lord spoke to Moses, tell Aaron and his sons that you are to bless the Israelites and say to them, may Yahweh bless you and protect you. May Yahweh make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May Yahweh look with favor on you and give you peace. In this way you will pronounce my name over the Israelites and I will bless them. The Lord spoke to Moses. Now it becomes a mandate that every time these people get together, they got blessed. Every time. So I'm going to give you two examples of the New Testament. Well, people getting the blessing, and the blessing multiplied, and other than people were getting blessed. It talks about 5,000 people, not counting the women and children, and the Lord only had 5 loaves of bread. He blessed them. There were 12 baskets left over. The next story we hear is the Lord feeding 4,000 people with 7 loaves of bread, not counting the women and children. Here's the story of we're getting more people fed with less bread. More people fed with less bread. In other words, he did more with less. You and I would think it'd take more loaves to feed more people, but not so with God. It took fewer loaves. Fewer loaves to feed more people. It's God's way of telling us that the bigger the problem, the easier it is for him. So whoever you are, wherever you're at, you can do more than you think. Just to start to finish that dream. Now, how did this all happen? Well, I'm going to give you a little, I'm going to switch a little bit. As of March this year, there were 17.4 billion people on the earth. 17.4 billion. There's only 13 million Jews on the planet. Do you know that Forbes says this? 20% of the world's billionaires are Jewish. 48% of the American billionaires are Jewish. 30% of the Nobel Prize winners in science are Jewish. Now, how did all this happen? Well, to the Orthodox Jews, on Friday evenings in their home, the fathers laid hands on their children and pronounced God's blessing on them. That's how it is. So for 2,000 years, well, for 2,000 years, at an early age, the Jewish boys and girls have been getting spoken blessings. The blessings express the very mind and purposes of God. It's prophetic. It's prophetic for persons receiving the blessing. It's calling those things to not as though they are, as God is intending them to be. The blessing breaks the curse. It sends light into the darkness and blesses God's creation. It communicates several things: love, value, and belonging. The purpose, from power to purpose, from anointing to ability. Any blessing is blessing the no blessing. Let me give some examples of the blessings that in my life that I've seen happen. This is in the neighborhood. There's a ministry, a couple ministries up the highway, not very far. Fountain of Hope Generations Outreach. 5 years ago, Fountain of Hope was a food ministry. 5 years ago, a couple men started passing out about 25 sandwiches a day in the neighborhood to feed the poor. Today, that ministry, the ministry has been blessed every day for 5 years. Today, they're feeding over 15,000 people a month. They got 10 full-time employees, and I don't know, at least 10 full-time volunteers. Generations Outreach has a program for the youth in the area. They have a computer program to teach the kids. They have an outreach for the young kids in the neighborhood to get involved in the ministry there. And they also have what's called an aquaponics program. The aquaponics program is a way to build, harvest food inside. I'd recommend everybody in this room to check that out. Now I got to tell you some personal things about the blessing. I have a son-in-law. 7 years ago, he was just a laborer. Spent time in the army, commanded out of the army, just putting back porches on, maybe a roof here or there. Started getting the blessing. Now I had to come out of my comfort zone to start doing blessings. I was never blessed, but I says, God says to bless became a mandate. So I started blessing. The boy goes back to college, finishes college. And just recently, he's been a superintendent of a major construction company. He just finished a $25 million project in town here as the head superintendent. So that's part of the blessing. But two individuals that owned their businesses in 2008 completely contracted with their patients, completely broke. And those blessings just turned it around. I can tell you a personal one about my daughter. My daughter Grace, at 40 years old, miscarried. I don't know if she could have another baby or not. She became pregnant, and she had a group of doctors she was going to see. And she ended up, toward the end of the term, or in the pregnancy, she had to stop in and get another doctor she'd never seen. The doctor said, have you ever had your fluid checked? And she said, no, what's that? And he says, well, let's get it checked today. Well, I'm out of option. Tristan, but half the fluid in the sack was gone. The doctor told her, if it had gone to the Lord, she'd lost the baby. So blessing, carried on, we got a 2-year-old granddaughter now because of that. How it happens, none of us have been blessed, or many of us haven't been blessed. So how do we get a restoration? Get it back what we've lost. We want to get it back better than before. It comes out of Isaiah 61:7. The Lord says, instead of your shame, you shall have double honor. Instead of confusion, you shall rejoice in your portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess double, everlasting joy will be theirs. God says in his word, you will receive double for your trouble. He wants you to have a double portion for every trouble you went through. The moment you respond to God in faith, he gets involved in your restoration. You're going to get more than before, more than before. Not in quantity, but possibly not in quantity, but in quality. We know that you can be healthier, wiser, financially stronger, and more at peace. There's a story of Job. Most of us know the story of Job. He lost everything. In terms of a double in quantity, he went from 7,000 sheep to 14,000 sheep, 3,000 camels to 6,000 camels, 5,000 oxen to 1,000 oxen, and 500 female donkeys to 1,000 donkeys. And his daughters were the fairest in the land. Listen, Samson did more in his last day than his entire life, and it's never too late to start to bless. But we're talking about West End here. What is everyone, we challenge every one of you as you get involved, you drive by in the neighborhood, just put up your hand, bless. Bless the buildings, bless the people. Start to bless your family. That's what we can do. The blessing. I spent an afternoon with a rabbi teaching the Jewish people how to be Jewish. And he really emphasized it being a mandate to bless the people because they had gotten away from it. So my challenge to you is to start to bless the neighborhood, bless your family, come out of your comfort zone and do the blessing. If you don't mind, I'd like to bless each and every one of you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance on each and every one of you and give you peace. I got to want you to remember one thing. Nehemiah was blessed. And he built that city.
Again, I'm John Ammon, the Executive Director of the West Side Future Fund. But before we begin that, let me ask, how many people, please raise your hand if you're here for the first time. All right, great, so some people are interested in what I have about to say. For those that are new, the next part of our program is where we self-introduce. So I ask you to you'll have the mic for a second, to stand up, say your name, and the organization that you're representing. That's all we want. We don't want any speeches, although we know folks have great things to say. We want to, and we're going to move around the whole room. And the reason we do this is so we know each other, and we want to facilitate connecting, because we believe if we get to know each other better, we can then better get things done. So we really encourage you, if you hear someone in the self-introduction you'd like to go meet, please go introduce yourself to that person, and we can all get to know each other a little bit better. So we're going to go move around the room, and then after we finish that, we'll bring up our speakers. So I'll start with the woman with the camera, so everyone knows who she is.
Well, I'm Kelly Brown, and this is Box of Chocolates Media, but people watch the video, and they've asked that when you introduce yourself, remember that people go back and watch the video and want to get your information.
And if you go to YouTube and just search Transform West Side Summit, you'll find all the videos that Kelly tapes for us.
I'm Larry Walker of Generations Outreach and Next Generation Youth Center.
Good morning. My name is Cynthia Williams. I'm with Next Generation Youth Center and Fountain of Hope.
Morning, Art Frazier, Spelman College, and Chairman of the Board of the University Community Development Corporation.
Good morning, Don Blackson, Spelman College, Associate Director of Facilities Management Services.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Juan Rafa with Coca-Cola.
Good morning, Helen Smith Price, the Coca-Cola Company.
Good morning, Michael Perez with the Council for Quality Growth.
Good morning, Makara Rumley, Environmental Protection Agency, Senior Advisor on Community Engagement.
Good morning, Pat Downer with the Next Generation and Fountain of Hope.
Good morning, Brenda Williams, Next Generation and Living Worship.
Good morning, Charles Shelton, County Fourth County Sheriff.
Good morning, Lev Sterling, Oakland City Community Organization.
Craig Alonso with the One Desktop and Child Project and Fountain of Hope, bridging the digital divide here on the West Side.
Dr. Truett Bridges, a physician, Grant Park, addiction medicine.
Good morning, Sandra Bush, resident of Booker T. Washington Community Association.
Good morning, Brenda Cornelius, and I am way of Greater Atlanta.
Good morning, Roger Omiswami from Georgia Tech Salon.
Good morning, Lucy Thomas from Tech Solar Home.
Good morning, Anna McCowan, Georgia Tech Solar Home.
Good morning, Alex Boops, I'm the project manager for the Georgia Tech Solar Home.
Well,
William Kleshtow, Marketing and Communications Lead, Georgia Tech Solar Home. I promise I'm the last one here.
Good morning, Greg McPherson. I'm a composer and I write music for Disney.
Hello, my name is Dan Cathy, and I'm a friend of Shane Windmeyer.
Good evening, or good afternoon, good morning. Shane Windmeyer with Campus Pride.
Damian Boyd, lead pastor of the church.
Good morning, my name is Doug DeVoe, and I'm representing Vision Atlanta Partners, and I'm also a project manager.
Good morning, I'm Vita DeVoe with DeVoe and Associates Realty.
Good morning, I'm Mike Rivaga. I'm a TechBridge Georgia Community Impact Manager.
Good morning, Craig Isle, Georgia State University.
Stacy Stevens, Cox Curry and Associates.
Alex DeLeo, Cox Curry and Associates.
Good morning, I'm Deborah Ryan with Cox Curry and Associates.
Karen Ashley, SU Heights.
Good morning, Keenan Akers with Joshua Life, Landfill Director. Go there.
Tommy Lester, Vision ATL Partners.
Good morning, Christy Calvin, just visiting today.
Good morning, Constance Alexander, Environmental Protection Agency.
Hi, I'm Cynthia Edwards, Environmental Protection Agency.
My name is John Sherwood with Barron's Bike Shop, Board Chair.
Tim O'Meara, Barron's Bike Shop.
Patricia Williams, Little Williams and Associates.
Paul Georgie, Georgia Tech Solar Home.
Hello, so I'm part of Georgia Tech Solar Home. I believe you forgot about us.
You're doing over there.
Now, I'm Student Minister Louis Muhammad. I'm here representing our Southern Regional Student Minister of the Nation of Islam, Student Minister Sharif Muhammad. He represents the Honorable Minister of Prior County, Tennessee, Georgia, Alabama, and Mississippi.
Hi, I'm Ron Brown with the Winchick Foundation.
Good morning, I'm Scott Patton. I'm with Chick-fil-A.
Good morning, Edward Wimberly, Interdenominational Theological Center, and a season ticket holder for the Falcons.
Good morning, I'm Abigail Russell with
Laborers
Georgia.
I'm Abigail Russell with Laborers Georgia.
Good morning, Chris Weinberger. I'm with ClearPoint. Many of you know us as Consumer Credit Counseling Service of Greater Atlanta. How many tickets do you have?
Good morning, Vic Clemens with the University Financing Foundation.
Good morning, Sandy Mullins with Karen Counseling Center of Georgia.
No.
Good morning, Sarah Garnett with Fox Team Communications.
Good morning, I'm Herbert Gelp and I'm Chairman of the Good Samaritan Health Center.
Good morning, Veronica Squire with Good Samaritan Health Center.
Good morning, Keith Robson, Mayor's Office of Innovation Delivery and Performance.
Good morning, Tristan at Glamour, Susan G. Komen, Greater Atlanta. Good morning, Michelle Romero as a Sovereign in the Streets.
Nick Sharkey with Bluebird Fields Network.
Good morning, it's Maya Orange.
Cleo Orange.
Good morning, Doug Morrell, Habitat for Humanity International.
Good morning, Luke Kent from Brooklyn County Controls Academy.
Good morning, Linda and Spice City Association.
Good morning, Jennifer Jackson Jones, Georgia Department of Education.
Good morning, Constance Sandy with Tech Consulting, Urban County and City Engagement.
Good morning, Sam Pritchett, President of Marsh Brown College, and I was on time last week.
Hi, I'm Jonathan Melvin. This is my son Henry. We are residents of Vine City and I'm a licensed general contractor.
Good morning, Jay Scott with Green North Partners.
Good morning, Paul Morris with Metabolic.
Good morning, Evan Gronovich. I'm just here to make sure everybody eats more chicken.
Good morning, I'm Linda Cannon with Healing Community Center here in the West Side South.
Southwest Atlanta.
I saw Nathan Ackmar Hotel, Storytown.
Good morning, I'm Catherine Strollo with the Home Depot Foundation.
Good morning, Cindy Abel with Hands On Atlanta.
Good morning, I'm Jelena Cagle with Hands On Atlanta.
Good morning, Jack Casey, Wisconsin Medicine.
Good morning, Tom Jack with Jack Davis Realty.
Good morning, Pierre Rungie, Mayor's Office of Sustainability and App Eco District.
Good morning, Priscilla Cala with Molson Park.
Good morning, Natasha Malvin, Bryan City resident and a Georgia State, Georgia Tech public policy student.
Good morning, everyone. Linda Baffel, I work for ASEAN for Public Health Research and Evaluation Firms, and I'm a former resident of Washington.
Good morning, I'm Greg Harris, Life University and its Center for Secular Ethics.
Good morning, y'all. I'm Trey Kaysen, I'm with Georgia Washington.
Good morning, I'm Mark Moody, Multicultural Initiatives with the American Conversation.
Good morning, I'm Dave Bracer with Cox Curry & Associates.
Good morning, I'm Julio Martinez with the Center for Sustainable Communities.
I'm Michael James from Chick-fil-A.
Good morning, my name is Robin Stokes, Bushcraft from Lane.
Good morning, my name is Julia Trish. I'm with Habitat for Humanity International.
My name is Rodney Davis. I'm part of AC Shut It Down in Morehouse College, senior physics major, and I'm here for deliberation of all black folks. Isn't that right, Dan Kevin?
Good morning, everybody. I'm Chris Brooks, a junior at Spelman College, also member of AC Shut It Down. I'm also here for deliberation of black folks and to call out all the good gentrifiers in the room.
Hello
everyone,
my name is
Neil Smith, I'm from
Spelman College, I'm also
part of
the AC
Shutdown.
Good morning, my name is Yvonne
Wagner and I work at Atlanta Community
Bank. Good morning, I'm Montez Morgan, Georgia Tech
grad, Atlanta Hawks. Hello, I'm Keith Sharp with Keller Williams Realty, MWG, Groundwork Atlanta, and the Park Creek Stewardship Council.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Dan Murphy. I'm with the Relay Bike Share.
Good morning. I'm Apriya Brown with 2B Youth Development Foundation. We offer mentor and internships there.
Good morning. I'm Victor Ventura, the owner of Road Dry LLC.
Good morning. I'm Susan Grant, Morehouse School of Medicine, on Board of Trustees.
Good morning, I'm Natasha Harrison with Community Build Ventures and coach for Westside Momentum.
Good morning, I'm Johnny Harrison.
Kathy Rams, community volunteer, philanthropic consultant.
I'll go again. TNA is Josh Levine.
I'm Saranda Howard, resident of Atlanta City.
Good morning. Blessings to everyone this morning, Arthur Bussin.
Good morning. My name is Buddy Eads, officer for Worldwide Discipleship Association and coordinator of Atlanta Arts Network.
Good morning. I'm Woody Johnson from Midtown Church and also a board member at Worldwide Discipleship.
Good morning. I'm Rufus Chambers, board chair, Safe House Outreach.
Hi, I'm Liz Blake. I'm with the Westside Future Fund.
Alex Dominguez with Chick-fil-A.
Hey, good morning. My name is Terry Ross. I'm chair of Neighborhood Planning Unit T and part of the Atlanta Engagement Community Engagement Playbook.
Good morning. My name is Barbara Guillory. I am with Star C. We do affordable workforce housing. Thank you.
Good morning, I'm Roger Liu with Fortuna 85, with specializing in bringing in foreign residents to Atlanta.
Good morning, my name is Alexandra Torado. I'm also with Fortuna 85.
Hello, I'm Susan Patterson with the Trust for Public Land.
Good morning, friends. I'm Tim Richardson. I'm representing the National Recreation Foundation and the Laureus Sport for Good Foundation.
Good morning. My name is Raven Henson, and I'm a student at Emory getting my master's in development practice.
Good morning, everyone. Robert Crumby, Carver College.
Hi again. Good morning, everyone. Linda Cannon with Healing Community Center.
Good morning. Laura Heary, Brookwood Group, and adjunct professor.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Tia Perry. I'm a fourth generation of the English Avenue neighborhood, West Island Rise, and Healing Community Center.
Good morning. I'm Marla Oros with the Mosaic Group, and I'm the health consultant working with the West Side Health Collaborative with West Side Rise.
Good morning, Sagandi Simon with the Blank Family Foundation.
Frank Fernandez, the Arthur and Blank Family Foundation.
All right, we'd like to get everyone, so if you were missed and want to self-introduce yourself before we begin our program, raise your hand if you'd like to introduce yourself.
Good morning, Anika Ferguson, Smart and Secure Children Parent Leadership Program at Morehouse School of Medicine.
Great, all right. Can you hear your booster, don't say
it? Good morning, I'm Bill Cannon. I'm president of the historic Booker T. Washington community.
Commercial Midtown.
All right, is it making my way up to the stage? Anybody else? The program this morning is on the Westside Health Collaborative Initiative, and it's going to, Frank Fernandez with the Arthur and Blank Family Foundation is going to start it and I think introduce others. When Frank finishes, I'll move around the mic for questions. We ask you to go for about 20 minutes or so, Frank, to 25 minutes when you do questions.
2 hours.
Thank you. Awesome. So when we do the question thing, if you want to raise your hand, I'll come try to combine you. And so one of the feedbacks I've gotten from speakers is speakers don't mind tough questions, but ask you be respectful when you ask your question. We've had a few instances where that unfortunately hasn't happened. So just as a reminder of kind of the ethos of our dialogue, great, candid, tough questions, but always remain respectful, please, of each other. So without having said all that, I'll turn the mic over to Frank, and thank you very much to you and your team for being here this morning to share with us the health initiative.
Good morning. So I'm just going to be very quick and turn it over to my colleagues, but we're basically going to tell you about the Westside Health Collaborative, what it is, its process, where it is now, and some of the things it is starting to do. But before doing that, what I wanted to do is provide a little bit of take a quick step back and provide some background. In coming to these over the last year or so, there are a few themes or things that have come up repeatedly that I think are important to address. And I'll start with two of them. One is this consistent question of how do we make sure that all you are talking to all the right stakeholders? Who are all the right stakeholders? How do we make all those connections? Because it is a really important thing that's come up and something we need to think about. And the second is that this is so overwhelming because there are so many different issues that we have to address. So what kind of framework can we use to start thinking about this work? So I thought I'd start there and then turn it over to my colleagues who can dive into the health collaborative and how that fits in within that framework. So the first place to start for us is really this three-legged stool, as we like to call it, of community revitalization, which is who are the key folks you need to be thinking about and engaging in this process. And for us, it really starts with putting intentionally community at the top, because really this is about the community, so you have to start there. They're a critical aspect of this. As I think has been discussed in past transformation summits, folks don't want this done to them, for them, they want it done with them. So how do we make sure that is kept front and center throughout this whole process? The second important sector is the public sector. We cannot do anything in terms of transformation or revitalization without an engaged city of Atlanta, Atlanta Beltline, Atlanta Public Schools, Fulton County. We need all of West Atlanta. We need all these public sector entities to be engaged. And thirdly, the private sector, which is a portion of what we represent as a foundation, which is why the folks at the Westside Future Fund are here, and a lot of the other corporations that I've heard who announced themselves when they were doing introductions. And that is a critical aspect of this work. One of the things that I got when I first got here is, we did this back when the dome was built. Why is this going to be any different? And there are a lot of reasons to get into it, kind of understanding that or unpacking that. But a big part of it is that the private sector was not part of it. And so I think one of the key differences this time around is that you do have this golden triangle of community, public sector, and private sector. We need to make sure they're all fully engaged and remain engaged over the long term. The second thing I want to just talk briefly about, it's kind of hard to see, hopefully you folks can see it, is the framework for which we think about this work. And for us, we really do break it up into these two big buckets of place and people. And for the Blank Foundation, we have a real emphasis on people, as you will hear about. But you have to be able to address both for this revitalization initiative to be successful. So when you think about place, you're thinking about housing. You're thinking about affordable housing. How do you ensure people don't get displaced, for example, which is a big topic right now. You're thinking about market rate housing, because you want to help the residents who are here stay, but you also need to help deconcentrate poverty, bring new residents in. You're thinking about retail, you're thinking about office, you're thinking about parks, you're thinking about basic infrastructure, like streets, stormwater management. All those things are critical from a place perspective. And so you've got to be thinking about that. You've got to be thinking about light and how that has an impact on the neighborhood. On the other side of the ledger, people. That's why we're here. And for us, we break it up into these five categories of health, education, economic inclusion, crime and safety, and civic empowerment. And for us, what we have done on the people side is really tried to dive really deeply into, okay, how can we really make an impact in these areas, and how do we make sure these areas are connected? And so for education, health, and economic inclusion, we've created these collaboratives. And the collaboratives are a cross-section of residents, community groups, larger nonprofits, funders, as well as institutional actors. And I'm going to let the folks here talk about the health collaborative and some of that. But at a high level, what each of these collaboratives is tasked with doing, and they've been around for different periods of time, but most of them at least a year, are one, getting a really nuanced, comprehensive understanding of the lay of the land. To me, I like to talk about it as this community balance. What are the assets on the ground? Because it isn't just deficit. What are the assets? And what are some of the challenges? And what are those gaps? And how can we develop a strategic plan that addresses those gaps and go ahead and execute on that plan? So what you're going to hear about now is the health collaborative, which is the furthest along of all the collaboratives that we've helped support. And I'll walk you through that process of who's a part of it, what we learned, the plan, and what we're doing to execute on it. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to my colleague from the foundation, so Andy Simon, can tell you a little bit more about the health collaborative.
So just to ground us all in the work that we're doing, I know we have a number of neighborhoods represented here, and we've heard from a number of organizations working on the West Side. But for the Blank Family Foundation, when we talk about the West Side, our Tier 1 communities, we're talking about really English Avenue, Vine City, and Casbury Health. And this was tied to the community benefits plan agreement that was negotiated with the new stadium. And our Tier 2 neighborhoods are Ashview Heights, Atlanta University Center, Bankhead Grove Park, Washington Park, and then we look at Tier 3 more broadly as the two zip codes, 30314 and 30318. So as we talk about the health collaborative and go through the data, you'll see that we really focus on the Tier 1 and some of the Tier 2 neighborhoods. So the health collaborative, again, is an organization of many people and many parts, but the key is really focusing on the residents. So there are two parts to this, really, is understanding the data of what the health data is saying from different agencies that have looked at our Tier 1 and Tier 3 neighborhoods, but also really grounded that in what the residents are saying about what they feel about their health, wellness, and well-being, and really matching those two parts. And so when I turn over the next part of the presentation to my colleagues, they're really going to share with you both the qualitative but as well as the quantitative side, because we can't do this work just based on data and studies and what, you know, the experts outside of the neighborhood say. We really want to rely on what the residents are feeling and experiencing so that we can develop the best strategies. But the goal is to bring as many diverse set of stakeholders to the table, so that includes the residents, the neighborhood associations, the institutional agencies that work on health, and the neighborhood community-based organizations that have been working on health issues for a number of years in the neighborhood, to really think about how we develop data-driven strategies and look at it from a 1 to 3 year perspective, but focusing on the long term, knowing that to really make an impact on long-term health outcomes, you have to be in this for the long term. So this is going to take more than 3 years, but for 1 to 3 years, we're going to talk about the strategies that we would like to implement based on, again, what the residents are experiencing and the data and what we know and understand is what's happening. So the purpose of this slide is really just to show you the power of many, because no one entity or group can do this work by themselves. And so we've really assembled a group of both residents, community-based organizations that have been working in the neighborhood for a long time, as well as, again, institutional partners at the local, state, and federal level who are interested in changing health outcomes on the West Side. So we have a number of groups actually in the room that are part of the Health Collaborative. I was going to say, if you are part of the Health Collaborative, would you raise your hand so everybody can see you? Anika, you raise your hand. But so this group has been working on the 1 to 3 year strategies and really thinking about how we collaborate and leverage the funds and the resources to make our strategic plan come to life. With that, we went again through the data collection, the qualitative and the quantitative. We talked to the residents, we heard what they were feeling and experiencing, and then we came together to think about how we develop a strategic plan. And I'm going to turn it over to Marla and Latia next to talk through the data.
Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Good morning.
So Tia and I were partners in crime in really looking at this data, and as Suganthi mentioned, we really wanted to be very comprehensive and understand what the numbers told us, but also what the people told us, and so we sort of tag-teamed to be able to accomplish that. And when we look at health, we really did take a community health, public health focus, because as we all know, to be healthy, it requires good schools, it requires safe streets, it requires houses that are healthy. And in the public health lens, we call those social determinants. All of those areas that Frank mentioned that the West Side on the Rise effort is really trying to address are really critical for us to understand, because they impact whether we're healthy or not. And so that's why we looked at the numbers, not just looked at health numbers, but we looked at all of the factors, those social determinants and areas that would really impact how people were healthy. And we started with the demographics, and we looked at this data, which was a little complicated, at the tier one, tier two level. We typically don't collect data that way. We collect it sometimes at a neighborhood level, but we kind of massaged the data, which we were really happy about, because we wanted to understand it as close to the neighborhood level that we're looking at as possible, to be very clear about what those needs are, to be as responsive as possible when we talked about the strategies. And so in terms of the demographics, we're in tier one and tier two, it's 22,000 residents. So that's not too big, you know. It seems like maybe that's a big number, but it's really kind of manageable when we think about being able to make an impact. So that's a really good thing in terms of understanding the size of the neighborhood and how we need to begin to think about addressing it. And 80% of the folks that live there are African American, and so that's obviously really important because we want to make sure that the strategies that we develop are very culturally responsive to the neighborhood. And so really understanding who lives there and the racial ethnic profile of who lives there is really an important thing. And we know we have a lot of challenges when we look at the economics of the neighborhood. About 40% of residents are living below the poverty line. Median household income is far below the Atlanta average. And that's a really important point because we know that poor folks have more health issues. We talk about the word health disparities. And that's because there's a huge difference, a huge gap between people who are poor and low income and higher income folks and their health outcomes. And that's for lots of reasons that all of us in this room really know. They don't have health insurance. They maybe can't get health insurance. They have lots of issues going on because they're low income and they can't pay attention to health care. They don't have access to healthcare because they can't get to healthcare services. And so understanding, you know, where people are in terms of their economic status, again, is really important. And so we're dealing with a population of folks who are very low income and we know are therefore going to be really challenged in terms of their healthcare. And most likely, before even looking at the health data, we're going to know that probably it's not going to look so good and it's going to look less than what we would think it would look for a higher income population. And then in terms of the environment, we see that the housing, we know this, vacancy rates over double, and we have substandard living condition, high levels of mold in the houses, high rates of violent crime. And these are all really important because we know that particularly the mold causes higher levels of respiratory conditions, and we see that with kids with a lot of asthma. We see that with adults who suffer from chronic respiratory conditions. Crime is a public health issue. When people are dying as a result of violent crime, that's a public health issue, and we need to be aware of that. And what drives that crime is really a lot of stuff that we need to care about in the health arena. And so when we really dig deep into the specific health data, we can see that this shows us the leading causes of death in the Tier 1 and Tier 2 neighborhoods. And we're looking at heart disease, hypertension, lungs, lung and throat cancer among the top five. And that's, you know, when we think about those things, a lot of those areas are preventable and controllable. When we think about hypertension, people dying from hypertension, that's something that people should die of. You know, we can control people's blood pressure with medication when they go to the doctor if we know that they have it, with diet, with exercise. So that gets back to, you know, those income levels. Do people have access to even have their blood pressure checked and then be able to get that medication? Lung and throat cancer, lung cancer, smoking, access to get those chest x-rays to know whether you have that early detection. Heart disease, we know diabetes and hypertension are big drivers of heart disease, and people dying, high rates of that means we're not paying attention to those things. And that's a sign that people don't have access to care. They're not getting their health attended to, which is why we have high death rates, people dying from these kinds of health conditions. And so these are really alarming statistics and help us really understand what we need to pay attention to. In addition, we see that mental health and behavioral health issues, which include substance use disorders and HIV, are also in the top 10. And, you know, this is, you know, as we know, epidemic around the country with behavioral health and substance use issues, mental health issues, people who are living in such stress that they're dying from their mental health issues, and then HIV, which in this community is a large part related to injection drug use. and access to early HIV care and treatment. And so these are, again, really important numbers for us to look at. When we looked at why people go to the hospital, so not only what they're dying from, but what causes them to go to the hospital, we see similar kinds of issues, the high blood pressure, the hypertension, but again, that mental health issue and those substance use issues and the HIV issues are causing people to go to the hospital at very high levels. When we look at moms and babies, maternal child health data, which is really important to us, we can do a lot better. We need to start early, right, with our moms and babies, because if they're healthy in those younger years, we know that they are going to be healthier later, and we have some work to do. We have very high percentages of teen birth rates, double the Georgia average, and we know that when young people have babies and they don't have all the support that they could have, then we have children who may not be as healthy, or a mom who may not be able to achieve her goals. And so having, you know, young people have babies early is something we need to really pay attention to, because it has implications for the health and future outcomes of those families later in life. We have higher percentages of premature births, so babies born too early, earlier than we would expect. Babies born low birth weight, so not at optimal weight, and we have lots of women in our neighborhood who are moms who have less than a 12th grade education. And so we know that babies who are born with lower preterm or less than optimal weight, again, we have to pay a lot of attention to those babies and young children, because they can have lots of health issues in those early years that we need to know about. So we need to find them, because we know that those are risk factors for those early kinds of health issues, and we need to make sure that we attend to them, because if we don't, those babies are gonna have lots of issues growing up as young children. They're not gonna be as successful in school because of these health issues. So this period, these babies born healthy and that early period is really fundamental to us having young people that grow up into healthy adolescents and adults. So I'm going to turn it over. That's what the numbers told us. Lots of need in terms of access to care and chronic disease and healthy babies. But that's what the numbers told us. But that wasn't the real story. And so Tia really got out there and got us the voice of the community. I'm going to turn it over to her so she can tell you.
Good morning, everybody. Bear with me, my voice gone a little bit from being out of the field. In order to collect this data, I had to do 10 projects, and within those 10 projects, I conducted 5 of them in the classroom, but I did the other 5 in the field. And the reason why it's important to get out in the field is that you have to get out and reach my people.
Yeah.
You can't just send anybody to my neighborhood to talk to my people. You have to have somebody there that can relate to them, that know their issues. The 5 that I did in the field, I was able to go door to door, basically talk to more community residents, basically the elderly. Because within our neighborhood, we probably have about maybe 7 elderly people out of 26 that we had. And the majority of them either have asthma or COPD. They go on machines, humidifiers, I have to go to check on them every day. And a lot of their homes have mold, mildew, lead poison. I also try to check them on a daily basis, because they won't let anybody into their homes. You know, we have a trust issue in English Avenue. And by me being a 4th generation, I get a chance to go into their homes and talk to them, because a lot of us have diabetes. A lot of us don't even have IDs or Social Security cards to even get health insurance. We don't have medical insurance, health insurance, life insurance. I mean, we're really struggling over there. We have no resources. And the resources that we have now, I mean, I'm very glad that we do have them, but right now we're in such a dire state. You know, it's hard to bring us back to the point to where my great grandma was living. Now, we conducted also a lot of health fairs. Mom got a chance to get out and talk to people, because it's hard to get my people to even walk over. And one thing about us, y'all, in our neighborhood, the word free rings a bell. So we have our health forms, we see food, bags, something, breath, attention, music, that's how you get us. But when she had these talks with my brother, a lot of those people, they had diabetes, HIV, COPD, asthma, and the majority of my neighborhood is in a very bad state. So that's why I always tell people that I talk to, I would rather for them to set up a field trip. I call it a field trip, and it's really a walkthrough. So you yourselves get to see how we live. You know, it's such a trip when we get out to see how we're really living. If our homes either have asbestos, mold, mildew, our creek, half our homes sit on the creek, which is contaminated. We test the water every Thursday. It's terrible, guys. So I would appreciate if you guys could just come out sometimes, get me to meet Marla or Samantha or Frank, and take a tour so you can see these things for yourself.
Thanks, Tia. Yeah. She did a good job.
So as Tia said, I just want to mention that she really did get out there and conduct these surveys and these listening sessions, and you know, we pulled all that data that she collected together, and it kind of ran true again to what the hard numbers. So this is what the folks said, and you can see it's consistent with what the numbers said. So you can see that the biggest health concern that folks were telling Tia and us when we were out there was their blood pressure. Mental health was actually over and over again named. And that was really surprising to us because we know that folks have stress and we know that they see their stress. But for folks to really name that and call out asking for that help is really a pretty powerful call for action. In a community where we know there's a lot of fear of getting help for mental health concerns. And so, you know, this was really an important signal for us. But you can see respiratory health, high cholesterol, which we know leads to that heart disease, and diabetes, cancer, stroke. So all those things that those numbers were telling us, the community really knew. They know what is going on, and these are their big concerns. When we asked them some specific questions about where they get their health care, over half of folks don't have any source of health care. So back to that access issue. We know why, but now we understand, right? We suspected when the numbers told us, but now it really was confirmed. No, I don't go. I don't have anywhere to go. And over almost half haven't visited the healthcare provider for regular checkups. So again, we can't find those chronic illnesses like blood pressure and diabetes and take care of them if we're not going to the doctor on a regular basis for that good preventive care. And 65% of folks, and this is just the folks we talk to, use the emergency room as their regular source of health care. And so that means it's late. It's to the point where it's a crisis. It's an emergency. We're not taking care of it on a regular basis to prevent it from getting to this point. And so, you know, Tia's work was really amazing to really kind of pull all the numbers and the data together to really paint the picture of what we needed to do. And so, okay, so you can see that kind of when we pull all this together, we really also, as Frank mentioned, wanted to understand kind of what was in the neighborhood, you know, in terms of community resources combined with these different needs and all the other issues affecting health. And what we found was that we had some assets in the neighborhood, which we're going to talk about in terms of the Healing Community Center. And I want to, Dr. Cannon is here as a major partner, along with Good Samaritan, who is also here, and Morehouse School of Medicine. So we have some really strong assets in the neighborhood, but we've also got a lot of gaps, particularly mental health and addiction treatment, particularly some gaps in services, food desert where folks can buy healthy foods, just general health education, for folks to be able to really understand how to get services, quality childcare, services to help those young moms have healthy babies. So there was a number of asset gaps combined with all that data that really came together to paint that picture that I think you're beginning to hear about the health status for the West Side. And so in November of last year, it's almost been a year now, the West Side Health Collaborative came together and we synthesized all this information and really said, okay, if we're going to try to address these issues in a three-year plan, let's really think, what is it that in these 3 years, what do we want to lay the groundwork to begin to do to impact the health status of the neighborhood? And so we came up with a set of four major priorities, and these will make sense, I hope, given what we just talked about. So one priority was the big access to healthcare issue. And so you could see that that's rang true in that data over and over again and what folks were telling us, that we needed to help people connect to healthcare services, preventive care services, primary care services, so we weren't going to the ED. We needed to impact those maternal child health data, do a better job with those moms and babies. And this is a fancy name. We wanted to try to deal with the high rates of death and illness associated with a fancy term called cardiometabolic syndrome. And what that means is all the things, those risk factors that lead to that death from heart disease. And in 3 years, we may not be able to prevent the long-term effect, but in 3 years, we can work on the risk factors, which is diabetes, high blood pressure, high cholesterol, high triglycerides, which are the fats that we eat, healthy eating, getting people's weight down to healthy levels. All of those things contribute to eventually people dying from heart disease. And so in 3 years, we think we can make a dent on those risk factors. And then those high rates of HIV infection, we really wanted to figure out how to make a dent in that. And so we've got a very ambitious, as you can see here, three-year plan, and under each of those goal areas. And so we said, okay, let's figure out what do we want to tackle in year one. And I'm going to talk about the year one strategies and mention a little bit about what's coming next. So in the access to care strategy, we're really excited to be partnering with the Healing Community Center, as well as all the other health partners in the neighborhood, to bring a community health worker program to the neighborhood. And that will be folks from English Avenue and Vine City that we will be hiring, who are really gonna kind of take what Tia was saying, what she was doing, that work, and really help folks manage their health care, get that health insurance if they're eligible, learn how to manage their diseases, get to a primary care doctor so they're not going to the ED. And in doing that, we know we need to, as Tia said, go to their homes, we need to go to the community, we need to go to the streets, and we need to do it with folks from the neighborhood who are trusted folks, who folks can talk to and begin to open up. And what we also know about this and why a community health worker with folks from the neighborhood is going to be really powerful is that we know that, you know, folks may not be thinking about going to the doctor as the first thing when they wake up because they have, you know, they're hurting and they have pain because they're dealing with their housing issues or they're being evicted or they can't pay their utility bills. And so these community health workers are going to be involved in really helping with all those kinds of issues that prevent folks from really paying attention to their health. And so we're really excited about that. We are recruiting. The job descriptions are going to be out today for a full-time program manager and two community health workers. And we hope to get that program started in November. And so it's really exciting. We'll be partnering with other programs like Morehouse, who also have some folks, community health workers, so that we're really maximizing leverage as much touch in the community as possible. In the maternal child health area, our first strategy is similar to the community health worker program because we really believe in the power of that high touch going out to people's homes. but we're going to focus that home visiting program on those pregnant women and families with young children up to age 5. And we're going to use a program that's been tested, that's well known, called Parents as Teachers. And we're going to hopefully be working with families first on that. They've been doing this program very successfully in other communities for a long time. It's a proven model. We know it gets those good birth outcomes, but in addition, it really works with the parents and the young child to teach them all that good nurturing and how you interact with your young baby so that they grow up, they thrive, they get their immunizations, they learn all that good early reading skills, and we really work one-to-one with that mom, dad, and baby so that they grow up with that good early hit and early start. In the cardiometabolic syndrome, we're going to focus on preventing type 2 diabetes. Anybody heard about type 2 diabetes? Okay, so that's the adult one, right? That's the one that you get later in life. And we want to focus on folks who what we call are pre-diabetes. So these are folks who have a little bit of a higher sugar level. They may be a little bit overweight, and if we can work with them to get their weight down, get them moving a little bit more, get those sugar levels under control through that healthy eating and getting that weight under control, we can prevent people from getting type 2. We know that we can do it, and that is so important because then we prevent that heart disease and all those complications that we know. And we have really, Tia was trained as a life coach, and other folks from our partner at HEAL and Urban Perform as our exercise partner, and that program is starting out in October. We're actually going to be recruiting folks for this program tomorrow at the Festival of Lights. We'll be there with our glucometers, doing finger sticks, doing risk assessments, and we're going to have 3 classes of about 10 folks that are starting up in October. So if you know anybody that has pre-diabetes, or if you think they do, you should get in touch with us, and we want to talk to them and help them and sign them up. For the HIV, decrease the high rates of HIV infection, we're really excited because we've never had treatment in this neighborhood. And folks have had to go downtown to the county health department, further away to the Grady Health Clinic. So we're actually bringing treatment to the neighborhood in a month. We're starting what we're calling a rapid entry clinic at the Healing Community Center, as well as long-term care. And what that means is we're going to have another group of community health workers who are going to get out in the neighborhoods where we know we have folks who may need to get treatment, and we're going to work closely with our partners on the mobile testing unit, and as soon as folks, we know they are positive, within 72 hours, we are going to get them to this new rapid entry clinic at HEAL, and we're going to get them their medications, we're going to sign them up for additional funding so they can get the care that they need, and we're not going to make them go all the way downtown, we're going to keep them at HEAL with newly trained docs and nurse practitioners who are going to be able to take care of their HIV. So this is huge to be able to really address this in the neighborhood, and we're just so thrilled that we're partnering with Fulton County Health Department. The state has been really very supportive and helpful with this, so we're really excited. So that's what's happening. We're moving quickly on our year one strategies. In our future years, we really want to focus on that mental health and substance abuse. Where's my substance abuse doctor? We need to talk to you about really addressing how we bring more services to the neighborhood. We're talking about school-based health services right now. And so those are really important for us to be able to address. In the maternal child health, we're going to be working next year with healthcare providers, pediatric healthcare providers that serve kids, to make sure that we're testing those babies early, doing those early screenings to develop, make sure we identify any concerns early and get those kids into intervention services early before it becomes problematic. We're going to figure out all kinds of ways to be able to do those screenings with both healthcare providers, childcare providers. We're going to do more education with parents and support with parents. And then in the cardiometabolic, we want to start working on those food deserts. You know, how do we bring more healthy foods, gardens, exercise, and so forth. So I'm going to stop there and see, and turn it over to T.
Let me just say one more thing, guys. The reason why I see like she just keeps saying bring stuff, bring the resources to us, because a lot of our residents over 20 years haven't even left the neighborhood. Haven't left the outskirts of the neighborhood. Don't know what it looked like on the outskirts. It's very hard to get my people to start being self-sufficient again because all our resources have been taken. But with this healing community center, I have started getting people to start going up there and resting. You know, because it's just a walk away. Maybe a block or two. You know, it's hard even getting them to go down. But I know with everybody help, all the resources, that we can start making my people be more self-sufficient and be more independent like we used to be.
Good morning again. My name is Tisha Harrison with Community Deal Ventures. I want to first just make a comment. I think it's the outline of the programming that you've laid out, I think it's excellent belief. When you look at philanthropy, I think it's an excellent belief, but I don't see that other continuum around civic engagement about how to really do system change. And I didn't really see a reflection of the system analysis that has created the current state of what the community is in. Mm-hmm. And what is the policy change work, and also the community engagement and community organizing around that to make those policies stick. And then the last thing is, I don't also see how, again, in this structural and institutional racism, how this has manifested in what we're seeing now in that system change analysis. So if you can kind of elaborate on your process and what are your thoughts on that policy work and community engagement to make this really stick beyond belief.
I'm going to maybe want to make sure, I think there was three questions in Natasha's, so I'm going to help try to walk, make sure I get advice. So one is kind of the role of civic engagement or civic, how do we, you know, community engagement. And so to me, that is not something that's just about health. It's about economic inclusion, it's about what's happening with housing, gentrification, it's about all of that. And for us, as you saw, that's one of the areas that we're focused on in terms of one of our big focus areas, and you're involved with one of them in terms of Westside Momentum. So one of the things that has been clear to us from the beginning is this dynamic of the outsider and the insider, right? So you have all of this outside expertise and experience and resources, and there is, which often happens, there is this tendency to want to say, well, let's come in and fix, provide relief, to your point. And you do need some of that. You do need some resources. You do need some of the experience that other folks have. But you have to strike an appropriate balance between bringing those resources while at the same time trying to empower and lift up the folks over here. How do you provide them with the resources to lift themselves up? And what is that right balance? I don't know, it's not a scientific formula, but it's, you know, you have to do that. And so for us, when we think about that, that's part of why we, you know, about a year and a half ago, we had launched Westside Momentum, which is a capacity building program for Westside-based nonprofits, where we provide training, consulting, financial support to help try to give folks those resources to increase their bandwidth, increase their ability to scale, and have a bigger impact. So that to me is part of it. I think the other piece of it is how do we make sure that this process is inclusive, whether it's in health or the other areas. And I think that is something we try to do. And I think the TA was a big part of, on the health side specifically, making sure that we're really understanding what the folks in the community are saying, what their perspective is as it relates to health, as well as making sure that we have participation from residents in the collaboratives. So to me, that those are the things we try to do in terms of the engagement. In terms of the second question was really about kind of at a more systemic level, which wasn't really what this was necessarily about, but I do think if I take a step back at least and look at why do you have the situation you have, you know, it's about concentrated poverty. There's a way I think about it, and that has implications about what happens in the neighborhood, as well as these big systemic issues like institutionalized racism and others. that make it really, really hard. So even if you're changing things at the neighborhood level, there's all these other things that happen outside the neighborhood with policy and politics that have a huge impact that we don't control, right? And so I think from that perspective, you know, one of the things we're starting to think about more and more is what can we do to help make the residents or empower them to be their own best advocates for change so that they can advocate for policy change at a city or a state level, because that's something relatively new to Atlanta. Been here about 2.5 years, but it's very striking to me in this city that the community doesn't really have power. Folks don't listen to them. How can we help change that dynamic? Because to your point, there are a lot of things we can do at the neighborhood level, but you do have to change some of that political systemic challenge that you have. And I don't have a ready-made solution because I think that's a harder thing, but it's something we want to engage with folks on. So I think I kind of answered your second and third question to the degree we could.
So to continue on that, going upstream, literally, water quality.
Louder.
Water quality. Having a great deal to do with mold, mildew, not only flooding, but environmental justice issue, that the way infrastructure was designed, the combined sewer overflows dump out in these neighborhoods. And so I'm interested to see where that appeared in the strategic plan, because under environment, I didn't see air quality and water quality. This is also very high. So under goal 3,
we can't hear you, Ms. Harry.
Under goal 3 and under goal 5, it'd be wonderful to see the larger regional water quality issue noted. And the stormwater park design addresses some of that. And unless we really engage on water quality issues at a larger level, you'll continue to have mold and mildew and environmental issues that are going to cause disease in that area.
I understand what you're saying, but that's the purpose of collaboration. We collaborate with Park and Stewardship Council, which basically, with WALRO, which basically works with the group, with more quality, with the storm drains. I have got out of many projects we built where we went out in the concrete, tested the water, took it back to the Chattahoochee River Keepers, and we found the problems in it. So basically, that's the purpose of collaboration. Park and Stewardship Council helped take it.
The other thing I would add to that in terms of environmental challenges, because Proctor Creek is a huge issue, and I think that's really at the core, a big part of what you're referring to. And I'm looking at Susan Patterson because the Trust for Public Land is in the process of building Rodney Cook Senior Park at Historic Vine City, formerly known as Mims Park. And for many people, that park is the first step in really trying to address issues of water quality, issues of stormwater management, which are central to that. It's not the only part of it. Obviously, this is trying to develop a Proctor Creek solution is going to take decades, but it is a good first step in terms of starting to address that, because it is a real issue. There was a sister action team, a Vine City-based group, did a health study in terms of talking to homeowners in the area, and a lot of the homeowners who live under the floodplains have had a lot of health issues related to mold and so on.
The Johnny Park is addressing stormwater and aging. And so unless we identify that as a regional issue,
agree.
Okay.
Yes, I work as a resident services coordinator in one of the senior high-rises here in this community, and have done it in several communities around the Atlanta area. And one of the things that is challenging, all of the health issues that you listed are prevalent in the community that I work in. And as a service coordinator, my primary role is to provide health and wellness resources in that community to help those seniors age in place longer. And so we do have the health professionals, people come in and do blood pressure check and so on and so on. And I've even partnered with the primary care doctor, and we've taken one of our down units and made it a clinic so that those residents who don't wish to go to Grady, which is their primary source of care, to go to the geriatric clinic there. But one of the challenges that we face, because they do, 100% of them have Medicare, Medicaid, so they have what is needed to get to a doctor. But what they don't have is a lot of family support and many are illiterate. And so when they get to the doctor, and they get discharged, whether they go through emergency or go to the doctor, they don't understand what the aftercare is. So it's not that they're not aware of what they have. Some have even made a decision that, well, if you got a diabetes, you got a diabetes with something. So they know that they have a diabetes, but yet they still choose to eat. And that's, you have to meet people where they are, so I'm not judging that. But the illiteracy makes it very difficult because you can give them, many of their doctors, they give them plans, they give them, yet they don't understand and they don't have that team around them to say, hey, this is how you use your strip to test your blood. They don't have that and they don't know. So I think that would be something that would, if you could address that, that would be helpful as well.
And with the purpose of this program, that's what community work, community health workers would be, for. Because I understand what you're saying, because a lot of times when I'm in the field, I have to hold some of my resident hands just to take them to go get their ID and social security card. A lot of us need that push. We need the community health workers to come out, go to the elders, check on them every day, make sure they're taking their meds, make sure they got their medicine, because a lot of them can't read. A lot of people in our neighborhood have got up in age, a lot of them, and they, a lot of them don't know how to read. And there's a lot of people over there that need rehabilitation as far as drugs, they don't know how to read. So a lot of us, we have to go out in this field, and I stay out in the field all the time, basically 7 days a week, to make sure that my people get these resources, get the ID that they need, get the social security cards they need in order to get them the health insurance. It starts from them. Sometimes you got to start from small, simple things in order to get my people. Now, I hate to use this word, but don't get it twisted. We was a resourceful neighborhood. We are used to having things. It's just that the last 20 years, things have been so bad that we have lost hope by not having no financial help, no jobs, no resources, drugs everywhere. So we basically come from a prosperous neighborhood where nurses and doctors live, but right now we're just in such a bad state. And then we live with the house that's deteriorated. We're looking at this every day. We walk past and act like we don't see it because we okay, got desensitized. So it's just a lot of problems that we're going through. But I know with this program, with community health workers, going out, talking to people, it will.
Just a comment is that the Department for Stewardship Council meeting is this afternoon at 1 o'clock. It's at the fire station number 28 at 1925 Hollywood Road from 1 o'clock to 3 o'clock. My question is, I'm familiar with some of my neighbors who use the services of Healing Community Center. Excellent work. I'm also familiar with Good Samaritan. I hadn't heard them mentioned in the collaborative. Where do they live in the picture?
So, I think we have a few folks from Good Sam here. So, the folks from Good Sam actually just joined the collaborative and trying to make sure we engage as many of the different health providers and partners as part of this process, because they do and can and should play an important role in this.
Hi, I work with teams in
Odessa
City, Wednesdays. The community's hungry, what she's saying about coming out of the community. So, if you guys haven't really been out in the community, There's a lot of need, and I was just going to put out an invitation. I'm a soccer in the streets, and we do free soccer in Bryan City on Mondays and Wednesdays. If you guys ever want to see how this park is changing the community and how all of this is going to make a change, you're more than welcome. 5 o'clock, Magnolia Street, come on down. We're working with the kids. It's something you need to see, because the community is changing. The community's hungry for change. And going to them is what's going to happen right now, because a lot of these people need us to come out there, and these kids are really ready. So please come out, join us. We'd love to have you come out and see what's going on in the community.
Bob Warner with the Inland Valley Partnership. Good to see all these seven we have on. Obviously, we work with you on a lot of things and with a number of your partners. First, I definitely want to commend you on the very kind of comprehensive, collaborative, community-focused approach that you're taking to this. I know it's a tremendous investment of resources and time and money to get to where you are. And while a lot of the issues that you've described are certainly pronounced in the communities in which you're working, they're certainly not exclusive or unique to those communities. And so the question I have for you is, assuming this is successful, any sense as to whether this approach can be scaled on a more citywide, to address many of the other communities that are facing similar challenges?
I think I'll answer part of it, and then I'll ask Marla to do so, because she works more citywide than we do. I think my initial response would be yes, I think, but it is complicated, because while a lot of the neighborhoods in this area, say in NPUV, another area that has a lot of challenges, they share a lot of the same things. There are some things that are unique to both. And so there's certain things you'll be able to replicate and they'll be transferable pretty easily, and then others that won't. And so it's just really taking the time to think that through and understand that. So one good example is the community health worker program. One of the things we found is there are a lot of different community health worker programs just in Atlanta, Metro Atlanta, and the state. And there's a real interest among some of the partners. So for example, Kaiser, which is a co-investor and co-funder of the community health worker program at the Blank Foundation, is really interested in how do you standardize community health worker in terms of the curriculum, in terms of how they go about their approach, how they connect to other services, because that then makes it easier to scale. So I think you'll find different programs, different areas that you have that, but I think you can get around the fact that you really do have to customize it because of the things Latia was saying in terms of high touch and getting out and talking to folks. You really got to understand the community.
I'll just echo, I mean, we are moving on the community health worker. November 17th, there's a big summit that is happening, bringing together key stakeholders that are doing community health worker programming around the state to come together to begin a conversation around common definitions and functions and core skills for community health workers. So we're beginning to take that step at a statewide level, which is really exciting. But I think we are scalable and customizable. We're scalable in terms of the programming, like Parents as Teachers is an evidence-based program. It's happening in communities all over the country. HIV care is evidence-based medicine of how we need to treat patients. Unfortunately, as we know, these communities have been disinvested in, and we need to advocate for those services. I mean, this is the first time that we have gotten Fulton County to partner with a community health center to move HIV care into the community and outside of a central location. So I think we're beginning to change those systems at a community level, and I hope that as we begin to demonstrate that and show these outcomes, we can take these proven strategies, because we're not inventing anything new. We don't want to do that. We want to take stuff that we know works, bring it to communities, and then bring them to scale. But it's really been because it's neglect. I mean, it's truly been neglect. And we need to all together, as Frank said, advocate for bringing these programs that we know work to scale in these disinvested communities.
Good morning. My name is Joe Evans. I live in DeKalb County. And whatever went on here with this week, talking to my neighborhood. Now, basically, I see that we have a dichotomous strategy of threshold and core. And these things that you're talking about, certainly they're good to do with the bad things. And until we get to the root cause of why certain people don't have services, then we will always have programs like that which you present. And we all know inventory management terms, life over vital. And while thinking about this situation, I have come up with another one. And it is called vital, rich in, poor out.
Good morning, Dr. Greg, interesting again. A great portion of our research for the last 30 years has been centered around arts therapies as an alternative to pharmaceuticals and surgery. When I came here from Boston at Berklee College of Music, and one of the issues that we continue to try and engage is find active ways to partner with people like the Blank Foundation and others, articulate on different initiatives to find ways to really give some balance in terms of pharmaceutical solutions. And I'm just curious about the efforts to develop a real solid arts profile. I'm a musician, but I've renovated film and all those kinds of things. I'm very curious about where that lies as far as an end component, as well as the area of community engagement.
So I want to make sure I understand the question. One piece of it, I think, was trying to think through kind of the connection between, in terms of addressing folks' medical or mental health issues instead of with pharmaceuticals, with arts therapy. So that question I'll, I can turn over to, I don't have a health background.
So I think it's a great idea. We need to explore it more in terms of specifically arts therapy. One thing I will say that we are really interested is in terms of the mental health model. We know that, you know, we want to, as you know, give a pill for everything, right? We want to give everybody a happy pill and think that their troubles are going to go away. And so we know that in this community, it's really not about a happy pill. It's about real stress. And so part of what we've been really thinking about is building on some other programs that have begun to do this. We're calling it sort of a kitchen table model, but bringing folks together to really talk and give each other mutual support in ways that can alleviate that stress. And I'll let Tia talk more, but as you heard, we have people who just have so much layers of stress and isolation, and it's that isolation and people not talking to each other and building that connectedness together that is a source of a lot of what we're seeing. And so just basic bringing people together and not saying, okay, we need to bring psychiatrists in here and we need to bring all these fancy counselors because, you know, and pills, that we really think if we can begin to have people talking to each other and supporting each other and helping facilitate that, that we can make a difference in some of the stress and the what we're labeling mental health issues.
And not trying to be sarcastic or anything, but we have enough drugs in our neighborhood as it is. So we basically would rather just try to find another strength as far as eating healthy, exercising, living right. We have a lot of demos that we have through the month. It's sometimes just once a month, and we get the residents together, young and old, and we let this demo portray how they feel. They come out and they tell us what they need, you know, and they communicate. See, we have a neighborhood that's used to being a family, close-knit neighborhood. When we gotta communicate, we check on each other. These, like I said, these things haven't taken place in 20 years. So I think the last thing we need is another people in our neighborhood. We already trying to get people off the drugs that they already on. If you get out of the store and talk to my people, you will realize what they need. It ain't them getting out and asking. You know, you can't do this, come in from the outside, do this day and make a plan for them, we're not included. You gotta get out and talk to the people and find out what they need.
Last question here.
Yes, in your discovery, in your profession, have you discovered, taken a look at how vaccines affect things, particularly young black boys, that are causing autism?
I'm gonna let Dr. Kavanaugh tackle that one.
I don't know why I thought that was coming directly at me. There are a couple of schools of thoughts, but in terms of the American Academy of Pediatrics as well as the American Council for Immunization Practices, the research that has been done on that definitely refutes that that is a direct cause. So you will find that there are counter studies, but in terms of it being a causative effect for autism, that is not supported.
I think it was the community survey. Quitting. Quitting.
All right. I've asked a few different times about getting copies of the presentation. But if you register, we'll be sending out the PowerPoint presentation.
The other thing we're going to be doing for FYI for folks is we actually have a strategic plan for health, education, and someone for economic inclusion. We're going to be putting it on the website, on the rise.org website, so you'll be able to go directly there to find it.
All right, so our speaker 2 weeks is Leonard Adams from Quest, so please come on back. Thank you for being here today.